So this is the TC workshop. You assumed to know some small thing about TC. We have a very, very tight schedule. You don't want to sit up there? Yeah, you guys want to sit up there? So it's multiple presentations, but some of them have, unfortunately, given our schedule, cut them down to 5 minutes. The first session is going to be Lucas. You want to come up here? Maybe just. We are given the experience of sometimes bugs showing up much later than anticipated and kind of patches going in. So the idea behind Lucas's presentation is we're going to try and create regression tests for TC. We don't know where exactly to house them. I haven't seen what he has, so I'll just hand it to him. So anybody, say, submitting a camel patch, or when we have some robot running tests at night, the Intel thing, or some other Jenkins setup, the idea would be to run these tests on camel trees and make sure nothing breaks. This is just the beginning. I accumulated a lot of test cases myself that were, I'm going to hand to young Lucas here to convert into his setup. This is merely a suggestion. If nothing better comes up, this is what we'll end up doing, the setup that Lucas has. However, we are looking for feedback. There may be something better than this that we could use. This is, I think we spent just a couple of weeks putting it together just for this presentation. So fortunately, we only have about 10 minutes for him. So go.
Okay. All right, so what I ended up using was basically Python. It seemed to have the best, the widest set of features and the best compatibility or the best room for growth. So I'm actually making heavy use of the unit test module for anyone who's ever used Python before. And I've taken a number of Jamal's tests and already converted them. So what I have so far is actually very, it's very limited in scope right now. So I think I've got, I counted last night, 44 in all, but how about I... Alright. I'll actually just start off with a demonstration of what it looks like, so... So what this is going to do, it's going to actually discover all of the tests that I've stored in this one directory and then execute them one by one. And look at that, there's a failure. All right, so in this case, what I'm doing with that failing test case is I'm adding a U32 filter that's trying to make use of a stored CSUM action. That was actually set up as part of my, as one of the preconditions. So for whatever reason, it does not seem to like my adding of that action to that filter. So I actually had Roman over here take a look at it, and he thinks he's figured out what's up with it, but we haven't actually tested a fix yet. I had to leave before that could happen. All right, so otherwise you can see that everything runs okay, and it actually gives you a brief description. Now if we're doing this in some sort of automated fashion, you can see that the output's actually coming. I don't know if this is exactly TAP. This is something I added 2 days ago.
So TAP as in test anything protocol?
Test anything protocol, where it basically gives the test name, then declares it either okay or not okay. It's actually really useful for managing your test results, I've found, and we use it at Mojitattoo for most of our automated testing. So this would be very compatible with Jenkins or any other kind of continuous integration system where you do compiling and testing on the same system. So
you have 5 minutes.
So yeah.
Sorry.
That's okay. Okay. So what I'll do now is just give a brief overview of what a general test case looks like. So with unit test, you have a single class. Here we go. Okay. You have your setup. Okay, so these are things that have to be done before you can run any of your tests. So this is setting up your environment. In my case, I'm just defining a number of actions to be used for the later tests, and then you get into your actual test methods themselves. So a single test case can have multiple tests inside of it if they're all related to one another and are maybe only slight variations. Okay, they can all be part of the same test case, and that's what I've done for this one. So I add for each one in this particular test case, I add the filter. I look at the return code. Okay, basically I'm only caring if it's zero or not zero. So I want to know if TC thinks if it has succeeded or failed. And then I will go back and actually screen scrape some output and evaluate it. Based on this pattern right here. So I'm looking for certain elements in the TC show or TC filter show output, so that I know that it worked.
So you assume that TC or IP.2 or whatever is going to exit with zero success or failure,
yeah.
Non-zero, and then you look at the output, correct?
Yeah.
Is that always going to work?
Another mic, please.
So I have a quick general question about the nature of these tests. So it seems to me that you could run these particular elements of the test suite regardless of what kind of configuration the system has. As far as physical NICs, or you don't have to set up networks or anything like that. So these are pure self-contained tests, right?
Yes.
I would like to encourage you to put it under kernel testing, all this stuff. Because that, for two reasons. First of all, there's a dearth of tests on the kernel testing networking by far, and we should start requiring people add tests to there when they add new features, etc. Some people have been good about it. There's a couple tests in there. Also, this means that the zero-day K-build robot can run this shit.
Yes.
Right, so.
It also means that your tests and your kernel don't get skewed.
Yeah, that's the other issue. So the only thing is that we'd have to add some muckery to the makefile to make sure that TC was around and had the version that we expected, blah, blah, blah. But Jamal, seriously, put this under kernel testing.
Do we really want to test TC via the kind of? Do we really want to test TC via the kernel interface, or should we actually just test the netlink interfaces and let TC be its own thing?
I think both are valid.
Okay.
Test scenarios. And since they already have this huge test suite that they're converting, it's there. We have it already. Yep.
So we have 6,000 lines of Python kernel networking tests. I assume that since they were in Python, they were just like need not apply. But this is Python as well, so
I am not fundamentally against a particular framework for doing testing.
Mm. Oh, we should.
It's better than what we have right now, which is zilch. There's no testing going on under kernel testing.
Let's take it offline.
So, okay, the only thing that would concern me is that you have a 6,000 line thing. You might want to modularize it slightly.
Oh, it's not one big thing. No, no. It's
okay, so I'm just saying.
The other concern I have is
we already have things like the existing NetDev script-based tests, which tend to bit rot. And so unless we have an owner that is maintaining the tests and keeping them up to date, we're going to have people submit something, and any test that bit rot becomes useless pretty fast. So I just, whoever submits it lists themselves as a maintainer on that subtree.
I've actually inadvertently volunteered to take that role on to basically.
The other issue is once it's in the upstream tree, someone will do something about it because people would want to add kernel testing networking into their suites if it is useful in some capacity, and therefore, since it has value, people will want to keep it working all the time. Mm-hmm. And that's the way I see it going forward.
We found it useful to cause build breaks when the tests fail.
Right, and that's why I say I want the K-build zero-day robot running this crap so they can say, oh, someone's TC changed, someone's action changed yesterday, broke the test suite.
Dave, do you see also somebody adding a patch to the TC subsystem running this? Could they do it if it's in the kernel? Or?
Absolutely. They can just do make test or whatever the rule target is. And we can say, you have to say in your commit message or whatever that you ran this.
Okay, cool.
And that's gold for you. You don't have to run it all the time.
Yes, that's why this came. Okay, sorry. You want to say something, Yoto?
Working? Okay. Does this test support like topology, like several machines that interacts?
No, not at this rate. This is relatively stupid.
Okay.
it's very simplistic. Like all of these tests will actually run in a separate namespace, but I'm not actually testing for the effects of the commands that are being executed. I'm only checking the results.
Okay.
I believe that there is the capability that I can add. Result check.
I guess we'll take it offline.
Yeah, let's take it offline because we don't have much time left. I'm going to have to boot you out of there.
Yeah,
can you put the second presentation, which is. So there's room for improvement. We have to start somewhere. If you have good ideas, please get hold of Lucas, myself. Roman's also involved. And we can.
I just wanted to make one comment. I think it would also be useful if you have like a common testing framework where we just inject the packet and then we can check the result, whether it really took effect or not. Because just the comment line where you said no, right?
No.
I think that would be useful for many subsystems if you have some general thing for that.
So if anybody has ideas on how we could achieve that, Yoto, we seem to have some ideas, right? How you could actually test. You're talking about injecting SKBs or just sending like a ping or something?
Yeah, injecting and then what was discussed in the.
Okay, so do you mind talking to us after?
Sure.
Yes, okay. All right. So Dan is going next. He's just going to talk about the latest and greatest with eBPF and TC. And he has 5 minutes. Sorry. Yeah.
Okay, thank you. So I just wanted to give a quick update round on CLS BPF since the last NetDev. A longer version of the talk with some more details will be on Friday. Since last NetDev, some of the major features that went into CLS BPF or eBPF that has been used from there is first the access to tunnel metadata. So we have this collect metadata framework that is supported by a couple of backends like VXLearn, Geneve, GRE, and various IP and IP tunneling since recently. And we have like a couple of helper functions that CLS BPF programs can use, which can set and get the tunnel key itself and also options. So for the tunnel key, you have a couple of you have like a generic structure that BPF programs can fill out, like tunnel ID, which gets mapped to VNI, for example. Then you have the remote destination, where we also added IPv6 support, not only IPv4. Then we have a couple of flags and like for checksumming, fragmentation, like the flow ID and so on. So this can be set and received programmatically, and also for the tunnel options, which is currently supported by VXLAN and Geneve. For VXLAN, it's the group-based policy extension, and Geneve. In Geneve, it's probably there. It's a bit more interesting since you can pass on like some TLVs for Geneve that you can read out or write programmatically. So that is really flexible, I think. just have a single net device and pass that configuration settings onwards. Then we have the direct packet access. So there are like what already existed in the kernel were like two methods for retrieving and writing into packets. One was the older things we had to take over from the classic BPF, where we have the load apps and load indirect instructions, which were the only like non-generic instructions in the BPF instruction set. But it was basically done so that the in-kernel migration from classic BPF to extended BPF was made a bit easier. But it came with a couple of issues. Like, for example, you can only load like 1, 2, or 4 bytes, and they're always in host and DNS, so it makes it a bit harder for working with headers. Then we added two helpers, one for reading and one for writing out data. They work pretty well, but they always refer to the EPPF stack, so you can only load or store from the stack space. But on the other hand, you have like much more number of bytes. You're only limited by the stack itself, not just by 1, 2, or 4 bytes. But the direct packet access is a bit more interesting since it kind of combines both worlds a bit in the sense that it's more efficient. The main complexity here is in the verifier itself, where the verifier has to like pattern match whether you're not accessing out of the linear data area from the SKB, and then you can just load the SKB data to a register itself and access the stuff much more efficiently than going either over stack or only being able to load and each time do the repeated checks for the classic BPF instructions. Then we have an event output helper, which is quite interesting. With that helper, you can basically perform some push notifications to user space, so the EPPF can set up like its own non-UAPI stack structure, and this thing is being pushed into a memory map ring buffer from the perf subsystem. So this thing was first introduced for tracing programs in EPPF, but this was really, we found this was easy to use and very performant. So it uses like a per CPU ring buffer from the perf subsystem eventually.
1 minute.
Oh, 1 minute.
Sorry.
Then there's a limited cgroups version 2 support where you can basically check whether your packet comes from a certain cgroup in the hierarchy. It's a bit limited currently, so we're looking in improving that one. A couple of improvements on various helper functions, like for better checksumming support, instead of just having 1, 2, or 4 bytes for updating, you can just pass in a div, and then it gets automatically updated through the helpers. We have some improvements for header rewrites. So, for example, we did NAT64, like some basic NAT64 implementation with that, where you can migrate protocol from V4 to V6 and vice versa, and some better metadata mangling, like packet type or regarding the hash. Then, last but not least, that I mentioned here is the hardware offloading support that got merged recently. This is like for Netrunner NICs, where they have a JIT compiler that maps that to another instruction set supported by the NIC, which is very interesting. So that got also implemented for the TC offloading backend. And so my other slides I will just skip here, but it's more about the core stuff and JIT stuff, but I can cover that later. So for that, I'm handing over to Jamal again. And are there any questions or?
Yeah, maybe one quick question. That's
thanks. So rewriting, is that only in place, or does it support like reallocation to insert new headers in front of existing packets?
So in front of the, so for the V4 to V6, yes. So it would allocate some new headroom if it has to.
Okay. I didn't know that existed, because I noticed that a fairly recent change in TC caches the protocol field, when you enter TC. So when you do a reclassify, it will actually still be the old one. So that we need to fix that then.
So that is being updated as well.
Okay, cool. Thanks. Yeah.
Go to Daniel's talk on Friday, is it?
Thank you. Yeah, on Friday. Fine.
Thanks, Daniel.
Okay, so kill this. I'm trying to remember which view is this one here?
Yep. Okay, I have two things here. The first one is we just wanted to give an update on how we're doing on the Qdisk lock removal. We talked about this earlier this week. It's coming along. There's a couple corner cases we're still resolving on the case where you have more than one Qdisk queue mapping to multiple descriptor rings. The details are fun and exciting, but I won't go into them here. But the basic idea is that if you look at kind of a contention on a P5O fast QDIS today, you'll see about 1.5 million packets per second on my system. And then it falls off by the time you go to 8 threads, and it falls even further if you keep going up. What we did is we removed this QDIS lock, which has a fair amount of contention on it, and what you'll see without the lock and still using a spin-locked ring is you'll see that in the single case of a single thread, the performance is actually slightly less, but it jumps quite a bit higher and then doesn't fall as much when you get to 8 threads. If you then use a compare exchange list instead of a spin lock, what you see is that even in the single thread case, it's better, and in the case of more threads, it actually scales even better. And I don't have the numbers here because they're not here. If you send me an email if you want, or I'll send the patches out here shortly in the next week or two, and they'll have all the data and even more details on this. So the next steps are, we'll probably do this in the initial step only for the case when you have one QDisk queue mapping one-to-one with descriptor rings. This simplifies a lot of the details about how to handle corner cases, and it allows us to start making forward progress. There's a interesting case where the drivers can stop the QDisk because they're being overrun or because of byte queue limits. So by doing this in the 1TXQ, we can kind of optimize that case as well. In the future, I have a few optimizations that are sort of sitting on my stack but have not been submitted at all. One is to dequeue multiple SKBs from a ring at a time. So instead of doing a compare exchange per SKB, we can take 32 or 16 packets off a ring at a time. This seems to be good. And finally, you can also enqueue packets into the driver. Instead of doing what we do today, build a big list, you can send them as an array of 16 or 32 packets at a time. And again, you see quite good numbers. The numbers start to, in kind of synthetic benchmarks, ignoring all corner cases, start to look more like the numbers you'll see out of package in when you run a packet right on top of the QDisk, right on top of the driver when you run package in. So we get to sort of line rate while going through the QDisk. It's quite nice if you use P5O fast.
Warning.
A lot of corner cases and stuff to resolve, but we're making progress there.
Okay, so. So thanks, John. Good timing. Any one question, Lau?
It's a little too many details for 5 minutes.
Yeah, sorry.
That's fine.
Anybody wants to say something? John has another presentation, going to flow.
You can always find me in the hall if you want to talk about this in more detail. A better way to go about it.
Go to the next one, I guess.
Okay, cool. The other thing that Jamal asked me to talk about is I mentioned that we have a tool that we wrote on top of TC, the TC interfaces in Linux kernel. Instead of using the TC tool, we use our own tool for this. And I'll give you a few details about it, and there's sort of an open question to anybody here. If they find it interesting enough, let me know, and we can look at open sourcing it, and maybe other people would like to use it. It's a sort of an internal tool at the moment, but not for any real reason. There's no problem open sourcing it. We call it Match. It was based on some SDK work previously, but reported it to U32. So we have this match D that you can start. And when it starts, what it does is it uses the U32 classifier to build up a list of links to parse packets. I'm not entirely convinced that everyone understands this, but U32 allows you to build a graph that can parse a packet. A lot of times people use a lot of the helpers in U32. This is just getting into really low-level details, but you can do TC CLS U32 and say, hey, match on the destination port. In general, that doesn't actually work because TC U32 just uses offsets. As soon as you get IPv4 options or IPv6, this breaks immediately. So what this tool is, it does is deals with all those details. Also, we sent a patch last week for IP Route 2 that TC link option was never working, as far as I can tell, so I don't think anybody was using this.
Oh, we use link extensively.
Do you have your own version of TC?
Huh?
Your own version of TC?
I don't know. I mean, we use link. Is it link or what's... Okay, we can talk
about it. If you use link, it's not being passed to the kernel because the TC command just drops it. Regardless of that, what this tool does is it... It builds out that parse graph for you, so you don't have to run a bunch of link commands and try to figure it out. We have a high-level language behind this. We actually have a couple. One of them...
this is where the test cases will be useful, then.
Yeah, one of them is P4, and we also have some JSON formats and some C structures that you can populate that give it the parse graph, so you don't have to enter the commands manually. Then the next thing you can do then is, because you have this, you can do this kind of command where you say match set rule, you give it a priority, a handle, you tell it what table, and then you can use kind of these user-friendly names like TCP desport and action, and what it'll do is it'll instantiate all the TC stuff below. You can see you can kind of intermingle the TC and the match together. We don't actually do this, but it's possible. Nothing gets corrupted by using partially TC and partially match. The last thing I'll just say is here's sort of one of our definitions that we use in the front end that builds that parse graph. You can say here you have a header type, all the fields that header has. These are standard ones. You could make up arbitrarily interesting headers if you want. And then what we do is we define how the graph actually looks this way. Like I said, this is kind of a piece on the side that sets it up for you. You could use a different JSON or some other thing on the front if you would like. This is probably interesting for people that are doing the driver work, offload work. We actually auto-generate the header files this way. We must have done a reasonably good job because I don't think anybody noticed that the header files were auto-generated. At least I didn't get any comments from the dev list and people reviewed it. So I think my tool is generating reasonably human-looking code. But if anyone is doing offloads for U32 in their driver, they realize that the structures can get quite large and quite long. So there's some value here. You kind of remove the ability to do typos and things. It's really an open question. If anybody finds this useful.
I have a question. So, just to make it clear, you are not interested in taking U32 for x86 and optimizing the hell out of it. You just want to have something that's human-friendly using U32.
This is just a front end to U32.
Right.
I mean, this is using the same netlink messages into the kernel that TC
right.
uses. It's.
But would you be able to extend your tool, let's say, to make it to make the output friendly to optimizations? I have, let's say, a million rules that I want to run on x86, not on an offload.
Sure. I have no problem doing that with the tool. I don't have a particular use case where I need to do that at the moment.
Okay.
I think your argument is that right now, if the details of U32 are that if you parse and you have a bunch of actions in there, it turns into a linked list, and that is very not performant. So you perhaps would like to use the hash tables more efficiently, but then you're hashing into a table, so it's a little different than exact match, which is what we're really doing here.
No, you can do exact matches, and we can take it offline. But you build a decision to offload this eventually into some piece of hardware, correct?
That's possible, yeah. That's not a problem.
Possible or yes?
I would use it for both.
Okay. Well, I mean, maybe we should take it offline since I'm trying
I'm
to
I'm not
be
trying to hide anything.
The time master.
Yeah, we can offload it. We'll use it with IXGB.
Okay. All right. Sorry. Anybody else with a question? No? Okay,
cool.
Good.
Thanks,
so
guys.
You're still next. So all right, at least I'm putting you on the spot. So I don't know.
This is my slide for
right,
the next
that's
talk.
Slide. Right there. So so the general theme is we're going to talk about like offload.
Okay.
I'm volunteering you to do the Intel offload. Maybe if maybe you can ask questions that you can answer, or you can just tell us what you do from an offload perspective.
Yeah, so currently the only upstream work that we have for offload is done on the IHGPE driver. It's supported by all the 10 gig cards, I believe. There's a few of the people that work more closely on the driver in the audience who can yell at me if I'm wrong. There you go. Everything
sorry,
but that one.
Just grab the mic before.
Everything but 82598, which is a 10 gig card as well, I guess.
There's a second mic. Dave, you have the mic?
Oh.
That's Dave's mic. You have to give it back to him.
Yes, so basically it's all the hardware supported by IHGPE with the exception of 82598.
There you go. There's your answer. And we support offloading destination IP, source IP, destination port, source port. And if we have a patch against the U32 to make it not jump to the IP header, which I plan to submit here when I get around to it, which will allow us to support Ethernet headers and things like that at L2. The basic idea is U32 always jumps to the IP header offset. It has a hack to use, I don't want to call it a hack, to look at Ethernet headers by using a negative offset. This is really...
You don't like that.
This is really questionable, I think, in my opinion. Yeah. And we would rather just start at the front of the header in most of my use cases. I agree there's probably use cases that only IP matter. But.
So maybe we'll do a Q&A, I mean, somebody else can answer. How many rules can you offload in the hardware into the NIC?
Ask that guy over there.
It depends on the configuration. It's actually a variable configuration. The default is about 1,000 rules, I believe.
1,000 rules on the IXGBE?
Yeah, for perfect match, yeah.
But you can do wildcard.
What's that?
You can do some wildcard matching as well?
Yeah, well, basically we can sacrifice RX FIFO in order to actually allow for more rules to be populated, but they're all essentially perfect match.
Okay, there's
match
somebody else
on the XGBE.
Yeah. What do you say?
So on I40, the number is 8K exact match, but I don't believe we support wildcard either on IGBE or I40.
No. Well, define wildcard.
/ 24, for example. No. Okay. How about...
We can do partial, but like if you're wanting to match a certain just a subnet, we can do that and just drop like the last byte or whatever, the last however many bits. So we can do masks.
There's a mask.
Right,
but
it's one mask for the entire part because it's doing a hash.
Okay. And actions, how many actions and what type?
Well, for IXGBE, it's either you can direct to queue or drop. Those are essentially the two options.
So we have a forward to, we can forward to a net dev if the net dev is a SRL VNetDev or a VMBQ NetDev, which is a Mac VLAN pair. So the Mac VLAN stuff works today. Using SRLV would require the virtual function port representers that is currently upstream but not supported by our drivers.
So the question on the wildcard, we don't support a longest prefix match, but we do support the masking option both on IGBE and I40. And the actions, like on I40, you could support drop, redirect, as well as things like mirror and count. But we're still doing the work for TC. We haven't really exposed TC on I40.
Excellent. Plans to expose I40 soon? Real soon now? That was a chuckle there.
As soon as we have enough time to actually get the development done.
Right?
I said, as soon as we have enough time to actually get the development done.
Okay.
It's the thing. Yeah, it's not getting the heads.
So the counters you say you actually have, because TC actions, for example, they are at a flow level or at an action level?
Flow level.
Okay. That always seems weird with hardware offload. Okay. You're off the hook, man.
See you. All right. Great. Thanks.
Okay. I think... Amir, you're next, maybe? Okay, so still continuing that theme of hardware offload. I'm going to bring Amir here. That's it? This is yours, right? No, that's the switch. Which one is yours?
The Lightning offloads.
Okay, Amir, you have about... I think you can go up to 10, according to the schedule.
Okay. The first thing I will talk about is the feature to manipulate tunnel metadata. We needed to find a way to classify by metadata, actually by tunnel information, and to set the metadata. So in order to do that, we had to extend the flower classifier to recognize the fields from the metadata and to release the metadata before redirecting it to the netdev. On the other direction, the action had to create a metadata to attach it to the SKB, and the next action to redirect it to the VXLAN, in this example, to the VXLAN share device. for that, we introduced the tunnel key action. We could leave without the shared device and without this new action, and to use a dedicated VXLAN device for a tunnel. But this, of course, is not scalable, and we wanted to use the shared device. This is the first feature. next is the same thing for VLANs. We extended the flower VLAN, the flower classifier to classify by VLAN fields. The action was already there. And ConnectX 4 now will have offload support for the combination of flower classifier with VLAN action. I'll talk about the second bullet first. We added the offload support to the drop action. Again, it is the combination of the flower with the drop action. It is now supported in NIC mode and in SRIOV mode. The mark action is supported only in NIC mode. Now the hardware can do the classification, set a mark, and further in the pipeline, OVS or TC rule can classify by this mark. It should save some CPU. The VLAN is offloaded, as I said. It is not as it is written here. It is only in SRIOV mode. We can push a VLAN and redirect it to a virtual function or a proper VLAN. Also, the redirect action, the mirrored redirect action, is offloaded for the SRIOV functions. All those offloads are having the statistics. Because it should be very scalable and there could be thousands of rules, and we didn't want to have a dedicated firmware commands per flow to get the statistics, we're using the capability of bulk probing that in a single firmware command, the software can probe all the counters of all the filters. Another thing is the last use timestamp. Because of limitation of the hardware, obvious limitation, we're emulating it using the software. Once the counters, the probing is done periodically, and once the counters are not changed, we update the last use. There is a bit the management of if a rule will be offloaded or not offloaded, or if it will be handled both by software and hardware, is done using the management flags of Flower, which are similar to the U32 flags. The user can set the skip hardware flag.
So I have a question for you.
Yeah.
So the statistics are per action or per classifier rule?
They are per action.
Per action.
Actually, in the hardware, yes, it is a combination of...
So you're the first vendor that I see that is doing it by auction so far. We signed to Intel guys. Should we?
Can you do it the other way around? Can you do it?
Say that again?
You said that we implemented the, implemented per the action. But
yes.
Can you do it otherwise?
Yeah.
So the Intel NIC seems to be per filter rule as opposed to per action. So, I mean, the way TC does it is per action, really. The actions have stats, because you may have some state. For example, if you're doing policing, you may say police, if it's 100 kilobits drop, and you want to have different stats for the dropped versus the accepted packets.
Yes.
So then you would chain two actions together, and you have stats for each one of them for accounting purposes. So when you do it by filter, you miss those kind of things. Right, so this is the first time I've had that someone is actually...
You can see that there is filter statistics?
You can have filter statistics, but I don't think they're mandatory. I mean, they're good to show a hit of the filter, but if you get stats on the action, then you actually have the statistics already.
Yeah, in our case, right. when you offload, it is you always have a combination of a classifier and action.
Yeah. And you didn't say how many rules you can offload on the MLX5.
Currently, there is a limitation of the software driver.
Software driver or hardware NIC?
The hardware, the driver currently is limiting.
Mm-hmm.
Or do you know what is the hardware limitation?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. There's no limitation.
Well, if I go and buy... Mike, if I go and buy a NIC...
So I believe the hardware limitation is a few millions, but maybe our recent firmware allows you 64K, but we are expanding that.
So if I buy one today and it's 64K, I get a firmware upgrade from you and it becomes 60 million. Is that correct?
I don't think we have this firmware yet, but if you want to code it... No, I'm joking. Yes.
The answer is yes? It's just a firmware upgrade?
Marketing-wise, yes, sure. But
right. I don't mean to buy some DIM socket from DIM from somewhere and plug it on the board to get 16 million.
Yes.
Okay.
And then when
will the firmware arrive? Yes. After this. Oh, sorry. Go ahead.
Yeah. There's the action mirror redirect. Do you also do the mirror action that copies the packets, or just the redirect? On action myriad redirect, there's also a myriad mirror action that will copy the packet. Do you support that one?
So the mirror thing is for the SRAOV switch offload, and I'll be talking about that tomorrow. So it's done in hardware, so no.
Does it do a mirror as opposed to...
What do you mean? You ask if our embedded switch copies it? It's hardware. It doesn't...
No. The question is... There's two possibilities.
Yes, we only support mirror redirect. We don't support mirror. If that's what you're asking.
Yeah. Okay.
No, we're not supporting mirror.
So you steal the whole packet as opposed to getting a copy of it.
He said redirect, right?
Can we do mirror? Is that an implementation issue or it just hasn't been done yet?
If we can do mirror in SRIOV,
just take a copy of the packet for sampling or whatever.
Yes, we can.
Okay. The answer is yes. Okay. Right. When is the feature coming? The other question was, can you prioritize rules? You can't, I think. This is just purely a table, a hash table of some form.
No, currently it can't prioritize.
Okay. All right. Any other questions from anybody else?
I can tell the question that you asked before about Intel. So, as we said, we can support millions of rules.
Mm-hmm.
We can support also different masks, and
I'm sensing you're bragging, Ronnie. So,
pardon me?
Is this just ConnectX 4 or ConnectX 3 as well? What can you do on ConnectX 3?
ConnectX 3 a little bit limited.
Can you do a few hundred, a few thousand? I have a ConnectX 3. That's why I'm asking you.
We can do a few thousand, yeah.
A few thousand?
Yeah, but...
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. I think... I'm just going to have to... You have another slide, or that's it?
No, that's the last slide.
Okay.
Or we'll have a workshop about the higher level of the use case of all those features.
So there's two other presentations that people can show up, or your workshop is on what again? It's on the SRIOV, and you will show some of this TC offload. Is it a workshop or a tutorial?
So we have tomorrow, usually a lot of us, I hope you like it. So tomorrow we have a tutorial on the whole new model for SRIOV in Linux, what we call the switch dev mode, which also goes to this stuff. And then we have a buff on this is dealing with SRIOV, so we have a buff that deals more with the power virtual use case. And we have another talk, how do you use the new model for stuff like Open vSwitch. So,
okay. All right, thanks. Okay, so there was somebody else that was going to show up. I'll go and then you go. So the way we'll go is I'll give the last presentation on behalf of Chelsea. Last minute the guy couldn't make it, so I'm just going to wing his presentation here. So, and then we'll go to Yodam, and it will flow into the switch dev session. Marty, I don't know where Marty is. Maybe you want to start coming up here. okay, so I'll give the Chelsea presentation. I don't work for Chelsea, so I may be missing some details. All right, cut that slide. So I actually asked the questions I was asking here to them. They do support masks. They say they can support up to 500,000 exact match and 2K wildcard. They could do 20 million per second lookup rate. Is that those numbers ring with you as well, the Mellanox people? 20 million lookups per second, and they can update from the driver up to 200,000 rules per second. Those are the fields they can look up on Ethernet source destination. I don't see source destination, Ethernet MAC address, Ether type, in and out of VLANs, IPv4/6. Fields, TCP, UDP, match encapsulated packages such as Geneve, VXLAN, and they can match packets that are coming from PFs or VFs. They can drop the packet, they can redirect to a specified, MAC VLAN or VF. They can redirect packet to specified port in hardware with additional header rewrite. They can rewrite headers. That's actually, I don't think I've had anybody say they could do that. Like change the source destination MAC address or swap them. Insert and delete or rewrite VLAN headers. They can rewrite IP addresses, so you can sort of do some sort of stateless NAT. And their statistics are per filter as opposed to be per action. Now, what I understood over the email exchange with this gentleman is they can also do policing, but I don't see it on the slide here. So that was the Chelsea T5. It's still Chelsea T5. Okay, they also can support QDisk offload, like the something that looks like an HDB offload. They claim they can support it. It's essentially, my gut feeling on this is it looks like HDB. Here's an example of how one would run TC commands. So you would add, you'll turn the ethtool command to turn the offload on, and then you'll start adding rules. And it's showing how to add U32 filters and actions. He's missing some things there, like what should you do here? Where's the flow ID? But the one thing that, because TC doesn't, U32 has stats. You can actually export stats to U32. It keeps track of how many times something matched and how many times something got looked up. And if they're equal, it means that packet was that rule was always looked up. However, because their classification, the counters are per classifier, it ends up being that you miss some of these stats per action. Instead, you get them per filter, and they haven't quite been able to expose them yet to using the TC interface. So what he's showing you is a SysFS output of the stats. He does promise that in the next iteration of this code, they'll make them available through regular TC. Okay, and these are the models that they support. quite a few versions. I've never used a Chelsea Nick, so I don't know what this is. And the plans in the future is to match outstanding challenges. Well, I thought he said he supports this, but it seems like it's a future plan to support these matches and to start working on HTB like Qdisk. And I think that was it. Any questions, you can send email to me. I'll make sure I forward to this person. Or if I can answer them, I will. But like I said, I don't have this nick. I'm only presenting because they couldn't make it at the last minute. Any questions? Yeah, I don't know how...
Because HTB is quite a beast to implement properly, while TBF is quite easy, it's just a rate limiter on a queue.
It could be something, some form of hierarchical TBF, basically. It's because they claim to be able to do hierarchical.
Okay.
Right. I think I was talking to Ronnie, maybe you also can do thousands of flows which could be mapped to queues, I think, in your hardware, correct? That may be the same kind of feature. Maybe there'd be reason to talk to them to see how you can offload that through maybe a Qdisk or something. Okay, and for me, that was it. So I'm going to, we have about 8 minutes still. So this is gonna smoothly transition into switch dev. You really couldn't make it, but the other two people are here. I can do the moderation, but I don't know if I can replace Yuri. So Yoram is going to go and talk about the Spectrum switch, TC, some of the issues there. And I think we have plenty of time, right? Yeah. We can now cut into a time. So, eh?
Let's start.
Will. Okay, so I'm going to put your slides.
This one.
This one, is it?
Yeah.
Yeah, okay. Okay.
Yeah.
Yes. All right.
F5.
F5? Where is F5? I don't see where. This is a weird laptop. Oh, here it is. Okay. It does work.
I wonder if it works.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. Okay, so I'm Yotam from SwitchDev, and that's what we did regarding TC. I will start with specifying what we did in the past few months and what we are going to do and what we are still hesitating. And it will be a good place to understand how we are going to do some stuff. So let's start. Introduce the Metro classifier. Okay, so our hardware supports, of course, monitoring, doing port mirroring. So we wanted to implement that. The best way we chose is to use the we introduced the match all classifier, which is very dumb. It just matches every packet. It's a classifier because it does what the classifier does. It just returns true. And it's like U32 with zero mask, okay? And after introducing it, we offloaded it with skip software and skip hardware, as Amir was saying earlier. This way you can make sure if you want to bring this rule into the hardware or into the software. It is important from time to time, and we'll see. I don't know if we'll see. You can think about it. It is important to have those flags.
I'll tell you the sampling is a good example.
Yeah, and sampling is also this one. If a packet goes up to the kernel, we don't want the kernel to mirror the packet again after the hardware already mirrored the packet. It's a problem. That's why you must, if you want to the kernel, the hardware to do that, you must skip software. Doesn't matter, okay? It's not the main issue. We offloaded with the action mirror, and this is how you can just make port mirroring. It's very easy, and you can see this is the command that port mirrors from SW1P5 to SW1P6. You can do either ingress or egress. So next one will be, okay, yeah.
Just want to make sure that everyone knows we're talking about a switch, because so far we're talking about NICs.
Yeah, okay, so I'm from the switch dev. Switch dev is in Mellanox. We implement kernel interface to a switch, and not the NICs. We are making this big box with many ports. So another thing that IT guys need is a way to sample their traffic. It was done in the past. It is usually done with this S-Flow protocol, which defines a way to how to sample the traffic and send it to some collector. We implemented, the way to do that on Linux machine currently is to use the IP tables. And IP tables, you can use a sample NFlog thing with the matching probability, and then you will get a sampling of the traffic that goes through your system. This thing is not offloadable, not for our perspective. We implemented another way to do the same thing. The same thing is to, by probability, sample the packets that go, and we called it using TC. And it's called sample action. The sample action, once put on a port, once put on a classifier, just matches one of every rate packets, duplicates it, because you don't want to touch the traffic, you must let the traffic flow, duplicate it, truncate it, because this is what S-Flow does, and this is, marks it, and adds some metadata. The metadata is done using the IFE protocol, which we used, I don't know if you know, it's one encapsulation protocol that you can add metadata to a packet, and the packet is marked in order for other TC rules to match it. And then you can forward it to some tab device and some user program, which we are going to edit the HSFlowD with the open source program that we are going to add support for this classifier, for this action. And that's it. This is how we are going to implement S-Flow. It's very useful and it's nice. It's more flexible than the IP tables. As you can do it to a specific interface, not the whole, or not or IP tables, is for the all your machine.
So, do you plan to use ULog and FLog? Because HSFlowD does.
No. The answer is no.
But HSFlowD does require that.
What?
HSFlowD uses ULog, right? ULog or NFLog.
HSFlowD.
Yeah.
Yeah, we know, and we are going to add the support for that.
In TC?
Support for this tab device that includes the packet that came from this sample action. That's what we are going to do, and we can talk about it offline if you want to, if you had another opinion, because we had a lot of things.
We intend to change the demo itself.
Yeah.
To work with
TC API?
Yeah.
What they're saying is an encapsulated packet to this demo?
Which
looks like that.
We are going to add this feature to HSFlowD. It currently supports NFLog and ULog. We are going to add this tab device.
Right.
Yeah, tab device API. Again, we had a lot of thought about it, and that's what we came up to be the most intuitive thing to do. And we'll be glad to talk with you if you had an opinion here.
We definitely have an opinion on that. I'm creating a device to pick up samples over here.
Wait, where am I talking to? Oh, great.
Creating a device to pick up samples is going to create problems of a different nature. But yeah, we should definitely talk offline.
Okay, so let's take it off.
The current model actually will just serve for you as well. If this TC room could service an NFLog entry, you're done, actually. So you don't need to change anything.
I know that we can take this the packet that we matched and NFLog it.
That's all you need to do.
I know we can, and we thought about it. And let's take it offline and talk about it, because...
Some generic infrastructure, not only for S-Flow, for other ports, in order to be able to forward some media application.
Right, so that's the much more complicated conversation that you're creating an device interface to support what looks like a TC destination. Now, that has its own implications, and whether or not that can be offloaded will have its own implications as well. In this case, since the destination is the CPU, and it's the CPU receiver, it's fine. But if you want to also say the destination potentially could be another hardware port, then you have a different problem, because now you have a virtual device hanging around that may or may not match a front panel port.
So clearly we have an opinion, we should talk more.
So this is eventually, if you do it like this, it's a wire protocol that can be sent over a physical device and be picked up somewhere else.
It is. You don't have to do it to direct it to a tap device. You can direct it to any device. You can specify the MAC address of the IFE encapsulation protocol is layer 2. So you can just specify which MAC do you want to direct it, and then the packet will be there and be collected there by some collector that you have. That's what we did here. Okay, so...
Can I just add a quick comment? I thought the mirrored action took a sample rate as well.
So mirrored action what?
It took a rate. So you could... I'm not sure you need an entirely new action, is all I'm saying.
No, it's more complicated than that, and we must also truncate the packet. We must do that. The hardware can at least the hardware can truncate it itself, so we must offload this. For example,
well, you could chain the actions together, right, and they'd come down as a chain on
the change
command.
The mirror action.
No. The mirror takes us. The mirror you can give it a rate, and then you could chain it with a trunk action and pass it all down to the hardware in one whack and
currently
do
mirror
it that way.
Supports rate.
I could be wrong. I thought it did though. No,
I didn't see that.
Oh, is it just the classifier that does?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, yeah.
All right.
Fine. You could.
Yeah, I think you could chain those actions, but this looks like one.
One big.
One. It seems like it fits together, and just like Daniel would argue, sometimes you may need to be less granular. So maybe this applies.
Yeah, I agree, and we really wanted to make it make this action smaller and integrate it with some other stuff, and we couldn't make it together, and we couldn't make it work. So if you have some options, we can think about it. We can take it offline. Okay, so those are what we currently did. This sample, I think that the patches will be sent very soon to the kernel. Next thing is the ACL offloads. This is the open subject. We'd like to talk to you about it, about the options. We did not start to implement it yet. This is the place to change the implementation, to change what we are going to do. So what do we want? Yeah, what is the problem? The problem is that we need multiple match action tables. We want to implement ACL rules. The hardware and almost every SDK supports several match action tables. This is a very frequent use case. You can, if you have something that involves firewall and a load balancer and a network function virtualization, you must have those several tables. I don't know if you must, but it is very convenient to IT guys. That's what they know. That's what they want. Also, with OpenFlow, we can get to that exact problem, that you need several tables. Another thing that we might like is shared QDIST. It might be comfortable. I know it's a use case that not only our use case. And it might be very comfortable to have QDIS as an object in the kernel, and you can link ports to it. But you know that's futuristic and to be.
What does shared QDISCs mean?
If you have a set of rules on a QDIS,
right?
Okay, and you want this same set of rule to all your ports, so you have to write again and again, and all this memory in the kernel will be duplicated again and again and again. I know that in virtualization and with Docker and stuff that have thousands of interfaces, it might be costly.
So you want one set of rules for every port.
So we would like to have the option to have this QDIS as an object, and then link several ports to the same QDIS because it's the same one. There is no need to duplicate this memory.
And you have some sort of thinking about implementing this already? Have you guys thought about it?
No, this is really...
You're just laying out a requirement. Okay. Okay.
It's a requirement for us, and we do know that our hardware implement that. So thinking about how to integrate the kernel with our hardware, we see that as a nice thing to have. It's not the main issue. The main issue is the first one.
Okay.
We already have...
I'm not sure I agree. I think both of them are in the same priority from our perspective. And the reason for that is actually, it is not a mandatory. It is a way to better utilize our hardware. Because we talked about capability in the NIC side. So in the hardware, actually, we are using the TCAM. And we have all the action you can imagine, and all the mesh fields that you can imagine. We can do all of them. We can enter a tunnel, modify fields, mesh on a fixed field or some flexible one that is totally polynomial, mirror, sample, whatever. We can do everything, but in order to utilize our algo, since it is a real DKAM, then you can have multiple data, you can have a real masks, and you can point for multiple ports to the same entry point in the ticket.
Okay.
So so this is why we need those hooks in order to better utilize the hardware. But in general, actually, we think that if you look at user from user perspective, this is the way users think. If you are looking at user that want to configure to do some firewall or load balancer, it is not necessarily tied to a specific port. It is tied to all the ports that come from the.
But in an ASIC implementation, is it there is a field which says port, for example, correct?
Mm-hmm. Actually, I can speak from our ASIC perspective. We do have ability to mesh on the port, but you can do wildcard on the port and bind the port to a table.
Okay.
So you can allocate the table and then bind multiple ports to the same table.
Okay.
Okay. So, another, of course, requirement is it will be offloadable. Yeah, of course. So that's what we do. So the first option that we thought, how to implement this multiple match action tables. The first option is with just regular flower classifier. We can aggregate those kind of rules. TC, filter, add, dev, you know, flower match. And with the action you want, you can aggregate like thousands of rules like that, and it will be very nice. It's not multiple table, but you can compile several tables into one big table. Well, that's nice, and that's probably our first phase. That's what we'll do. The problem is that it does not utilize our hardware. Is there anything important here? Oh, no, okay. So the pros is very easy to implement, and the offload infrastructure already exists in kernel. It's very nice to do. And you also have examples in the MLX5 and 4 and some other XGBE, I think, and all of those examples we already have. The cons is that it's terrible for hardware. We cannot utilize our hardware, which for some customers is a problem. In the TCAM, we can implement several tables. Yeah, and it will be very sad to have one big table. Okay, I think it's clear. Okay, so the multiple table supports in TC, that one thing that might be done. I'm not sure. Well, earlier somebody asked how many of you do know TC good, so TC well. So it's a good question whether it can be done. We thought about having something like class pools.
So in TC, I think this is we've documented this before. I hope DJ is not here to shoot me again. But the you can actually have multiple tables because the first phase of the lookup is a sort of a linked list of which. So you can have, let's say, a single U32 which will have many hash tables at a high priority, and then one of the actions will say continue. And you go to the next priority of U32 again,
okay,
which has its own table definition.
Yeah, U32 implements it.
U32.
So
yes.
You have
I don't know about flower. But we may need something generic that applies to all classifiers. I use this on U32. So, in essence, you can sort of chain tables. You can chain tables which do different things. Each one of them is a hierarchy of hash tables that implements U32. So you can actually say, look up this table, and at some point you want to look up the other table, or you don't want to look up the other table. You just can't skip tables. You can't just say, look up number 1, and then continue to look up number 10. You have to go to 2, right? Because the list is in order, is a sequence of, you essentially have a linked list of tables, if you want to call them. I hate to call them that, because some people just call them rules, and most people don't use this feature.
Yeah.
We do use it. Right?
So
but
it might
I will use it for U32. I have to think if there may be some improvement to be made. If you actually want to explicitly give an ID to these things,
mm-hmm. and have an action which says, by the way, skip to number 10.
That's exactly, yeah. That's the idea.
Right? Yeah. That feature doesn't exist. Has it been needed?
Which might, yeah. We may implement it. Yeah. We thought about?
No, we're in second session now. Oh. Yes.
Do you want to?
We're in switch dev. Martin, we're using your time now, right? yeah, that's okay. Thanks for reminding me. yeah.
We thought also about a classful QDIS that might have several classes, each represents a table. Might be more generic than just U32. I don't know.
I think we should be able to make all the classifiers. I don't know if anybody else has an opinion. Daniel, do you have an opinion on this? Do you have an opinion on this topic? Right now we have a linked list of the first phase of rules, but each rule is actually could be a table on its own. So I could, for example, call CLSBPF. It may have a huge table there on its own, and at some point CLSBPF decides I wanted to continue looking another. So
yeah.
The control comes back to the main execution loop, which calls the next CLSBPF.
Yeah, or you might have jump rule.
Right. So typically we use this, let's say, for the first time you run, let's say, U32, and then the next you continue to look at file mark, or you reclassify something, you can. So you're able to restart the whole chain of tables, or you can only go to next. You can't jump.
But it might be implemented.
It's not a challenge to implement this.
Yeah, that's what we thought.
If we have go to the next table for starting,
that's so
very good.
It might.
So
be very
go to next table exist and restart the tables exist. Restart the whole thing again. Go to the beginning.
And the only question is whether it is working on with the Flowerpass file as well.
Yes.
Maybe
this sequence of lists is actually, I don't know how the hash, I can't remember the hash table. It does create a hash table using rhash, the rhash table. I'm not sure if you can have one rule that then has an inbuilt table inside it. I don't remember that detail, but we can quickly work after this.
Okay.
Yeah.
It's great. Currently, classful ingress queries are not supported, so maybe maybe this solution will require this, so we'll have to think about it. The pros and cons are, of course, is pretty much that makes sense. We can utilize our hardware capacity with this. Does it fit TC design? This is the con. We have to think about it. It seems like we have some sort of the answer.
Just a small comment when you're saying it's not how our capacity is generic pickup capacity. It's not only Mellanox, it is a generic problem.
It's a generic problem for everyone that wants to.
So far, nobody has said that they want this, right?
Mm-hmm.
But I think it's a simple change. Not a simple change, but it's not an architecture change.
That's right.
Mm. Okay. Another option we thought about is integrating somehow P4 into TC, into the kernel. P4 is a language, okay, you might have heard about it. It's designed for creating tables, and you can add rules to those tables. The tables, in every table, you define what do you want to match on, and what are the actions that you want to have. It allows binding more than one table to a port, and the tables are an object that is not bound to a port by default. You can bound several ports to the same table. It pretty much fits our design. The thing is that the pros is that multiple table support is inherited, and P4 is getting more and more popular among the user base, which is also something to think about. Full utilization of hardware. It's very, very useful for hardware before. The cons is that might be abused to bypass kernel networking, though so does BPF, eBPF. And again, does it fit TC design is a good question, because how exactly to do that is not so straightforward. We thought about having some maybe TC P4 defined, which you can define table, and TC P4 add rule, which you can add match to a table that exists. but we don't, we are not sure yet how to do that. So again, it's the beginning of this thought. It would be good to hear your ideas regarding this, because it will be able to utilize the hardware the best way. And
so
it's not only that.
Yeah,
and the reason is not, again, we need to start to think from the user perspective, not the opposite, not what is easy to me to offload. We need to be, from my perspective, in order to make Switch Dev a real product or driver that all the users, all the vendors can use, it should be facing them. And from my perspective, V4 is a very good language to describe network, how network pipeline build. So there are some other ways to do that. Flexibility, UDF is one good example. The only issue with UDF is if you try to describe LPM in an UDF, it will take you a few lines of code in before it is just a simple table, and this is a basic table. So what I'm trying to say is that V4 look like a very good language to describe network pipeline. So we can use it as a classifier in TC in order to describe actually what the user is trying to achieve, and look to me like a good solution. And it will be complex.
So I think you're actually bringing up a very interesting sort of split problem, right? P4 is very good for defining hardware pipelines. eBPF is good for defining software pipelines, or rather the Linux kernel pipeline. There is a choice. We do both effectively, right? eBPF becomes a software pipeline definition language, and P4 becomes the hardware pipeline definition language, and forever we have a split. Or we have to pick one and try and make the other fit into that. And I know John has done some work to that effect, right? And I don't know if there is a comment of along the lines of trying to meet P4 and eBPF or interconvertibility of one from the other that you want to make.
I think I can say that, Mike, now in the record.
I think I can say that getting ASICs to run P4 is okay. Getting ASICs to run eBPF without NPUs is a challenging task. So maybe put this another way. Can you take an eBPF bytecode and translate that into your series of TCAMs?
It's very difficult.
Yeah. Probably not all the eBPF program, part of them. But I'm trying to raise another point. I'm not sure that software-wise, if you take a network guy, you will feel and show up both options. One is to describe the pipeline you desire, or the EPF, or describe the pipeline you desire with P4. From my opinion, you would choose the P4. So if it fits both, then...
So question, so you... a lot of stuff in like, even like commercial, high-grade commercial routers aren't necessarily TCAM-based. And like Juniper doesn't use TCAM, it uses fast RAM, and it actually runs code. It doesn't do parallel matching, I think. And so this is like a fundamental split. You can't run eBPF on TCAM, it's like a completely different model. But if you use whatever fast RAM that they use and you actually write code, because they moved away from TCAM, they moved to actually iterative processing. So maybe there is space for eBPF in such an architecture. It would run, right?
Yeah. We are not trying to replace the UDF. We are saying that maybe there is a place to another classifier, that's all.
So just a couple of general comments, and then my biggest concern. General comment is, I don't have any strong opinion about P4, but we don't have it yet. And if the issue is what the administrator network guy sees on top, he can be shielded from this with a layer. He could be shielded with a layer. There could be a translation engine that turns P4 stuff into BPF code, for example. Mm-hmm. So the underlying technology is not critical for the user experience. Okay. Secondarily, one thing I'm starting to notice is with all these TC offloads going into the drivers, there's a lot of complicated TC knowledge going into the drivers now, and this concerns me a lot. Mm-hmm. Because the scope is huge. Just as an example, something simple like checksumming offload or TSO offloads, which would be a simple stateless offload thing that drivers have to support, and the semantics seem to be pretty damn clear, it gets screwed up. This is orders of magnitude more complicated, and the semantics are harder to grasp your brain around. I think this is going to be a really challenge, a huge challenge for driver maintainers and authors to add support for this stuff and get it right. And I think we need some kind of common layer once we see a couple drivers get converted, because this can spiral seriously out of control, in my opinion.
Mm-hmm. But what do you see is spiraling out of control? I mean,
the scope of what TC is able to do,
right,
and the necessary logic you'll need to figure out whether the hardware can do that or not is a lot different from simple stateless offloads.
The capability discovery, for example, right. What can the hardware do?
Even to me, XDP is simpler because you either support translation of these instructions into something the hardware can execute, and it has the simple semantics that it can do what it wants to the packet, it returns an integer code, and then something happens in the driver or in the hardware. The scope seems so much huger to me.
So let's say someone adds, are you talking about adding, let's say, match this?
Even TCU32, this huge chain table, can I fit it into the hardware? How do I figure out the scope of the thing that the user is trying to do? It's not straightforward. There's a complexity issue, and we have to address it somehow.
There's definitely a complexity. I mean, maybe the way you express a match using U32 for one piece of hardware may be different than the other. Is that what you're getting to? Or?
I'm just getting to the translation from what the thing is that the user is asking us to do to what you do in the hardware. There's a lot of knowledge in here that's seeping into the drivers. The drivers are now knowing how the TC internal data structures, how they work, and they have to parse this stuff.
Is that what you're seeing, or? I wasn't sure.
When the user wants to use our offloads, he must read in our, he should look at our the documentation and see how to offload it, and if you even want to do what we are saying there, even though it might work on software, we won't be offloaded because we cannot offload all TC. You're right, it's a problem.
Actually, from that reason, we are working the opposite. We're saying, okay, if you want to achieve hot milling, this is the rule you should configure.
Yeah,
right.
That's what we do.
If you want to achieve the
documentation,
this is the rule you should configure. If you want to get auto entry, this is the rule you should configure. Not the opposite. We are not saying, okay,
yeah, right. So we reject bad configurations, basically.
No, to be honest, we are not at that stage. We only trying to figure out how we are going to do auto. So, but the general answer is probably yes.
Yeah, well,
probably
currently what we implement.
All the TC, the hardware, and with all the jump part and all the chaining of stable parts,
right.
It is still complicated to understand what the user expects to get. And actually, I think that hardware may behave different in that part. Even if you take an Apple TCAM, TCAM in hardware, it relies on different stages in the pipe, in different hardware.
Of course. That I appreciate, yeah.
Yeah, and I agree that it's not ideal. But we need to, in order for switch dev.
So something like eBPF may have made more sense in this case?
I guess. It makes your old stuff much more complicated.
Okay.
But I totally agree that we need to get going with it, see what we can achieve, maybe have some other vendor to do it as well, and then figure out what's the best way.
Mm-hmm. All right. Okay, so you have any more slides? Or? So we just ate over 20 minutes of his time. So
okay.
You have another one?
Or?
Any more questions for your turn? Yeah.
Yeah.
Mike, give us a mic there.
So actually, while you're waiting for the mic, I do have a question along the complexity question. So one thing that I'm noticing, even in the TC offloads, right, is that there are lots of conditionals in the driver implementation. There's lots of things that, if not this, if not that, then skip. And I think I'll second Dave's comment that if there, it needs to get more binary. Either it's offloaded or it's not. Like if you say conditionals exist, it's going to lead to a very complicated end user experience where it's not just read the documentation, it's read the bloody driver code to figure out.
But if you have capability exchange, will this solve it?
How complex are you going to make that?
Can you support a 5-tuple classifier? Can you support a row 32 classifier?
Won't be enough, like Matty said, like especially even on this hardware, where you apply what will make a difference. A simple, like, is it a 5-tuple match will not be sufficient.
Well, I mean, at basic, you should be able to take a 5-tuple and say, I'm going to map it to my pipeline.
That's easy.
Right. Yeah, the only challenge is what happens when you have a cascading of classifiers. That's where complexity is.
Cascading on classifier and different action that with counters on each one of them.
However, if someone's hardware supports it, why are we not allowing that?
No, that's fine.
Right. Okay.
Jim, how can you like see if a TC rule actually got into the hardware or not?
You add it. Do you answer that question?
Once you do skip software, then the TC will fail if the rule does not reach the hardware. This is the TC architecture.
So TC, because after I loaded the TC rule, can I then list and see this TC rule is offloaded and this is not?
That's there.
Yeah.
So you can actually tell what's offloaded in hardware or if it's offloaded both in software and hardware.
It's in the TC output somewhere.
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay.
It does sort of bring up the fact that the whole TC UI has very terrible error handling, and when you offload things, it gets even worse.
Yeah, it is terrible.
Basically, you do something wrong, there's a 10% chance the user space will catch it, there's an 80% chance the kernel will catch it, and now it's going to be even worse because a lot of these hardware offloads, you can't talk to them synchronously, you have to talk to them asynchronously, so the kernel's going to basically have to say, I'll take this, I'm going to talk on a slow path back to some switch.
So are you talking about general, okay, so there's two things. You get the ENVAL, the famous ENVAL, which doesn't tell you much.
Right, you get the ENVAL from the kernel, and it could be even worse in the case of a hardware offload where you have the equivalent of ENVAL from the switch.
But you don't know what it means.
And it never gets back as an error code, even to TC, because it has to be handled asynchronously.
Okay, that's a different issue. I brought that up in NetConf, but...
Anyway, so the point is that at some point, there needs to be a better error handling, logging, whatever infrastructure. We may not be able to fix the return codes, but we can at least figure out some standardized way to say, you did this, that's not going to work.
So I think there's two issues there. One is definitely the error handling that generic to Netlink itself.
Right.
The fact that it tells you an ENVAL because something in hardware failed.
Mm-hmm.
There's not a lot of to go by, and nobody's allowed to put a print K or a print log in the kernel to say, to give further info. I used to submit patches which will print what just happened instead of just returning an ENVAL.
Yeah.
I was talking to Hannes actually. He had some ideas. I'm just going to put him on the spot on how we could return a Netlink message with a lot more information when something goes wrong.
Yeah, just an internal text log, or if you want to go systemd superstructured, fine. It's not the standard kernel log, an error log that's available.
No, your point is taken that the surface area is bigger now because we're offloading to hardware of things that are cryptic on what they mean. Right? Is that what your message was? Okay.
Yeah, we actually thought a bit about implementing some functionality to make TC more usable, like, for example, tab completion or something.
With the user space app.
To make it a bit more usable. For example, when you don't know the QDIS handles, you just can tab, and the tool can ask the kernel and bring you the... it might be done. We thought about it. We might do that this year. We hope.
Okay, so I think, that's a different... that's yet another dimension.
Okay.
But there's the idea that if the switch could return... the kernel could return, because we do return, when something succeeds, we return an L message error.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
user space could request to say, I know how to handle extended errors. So you send a message to the kernel through TC. It's not really TC, it's anything that uses Netlink. The kernel will take, will return you not just the response, but also a TLV encapsulated with a lot more details about what the error was.
Mm. Might be very useful.
Right.
I think the problem are the details and not like that we can add a message, give me an extended error message, but like how to specify the errors. So BPF basically uses ASCII strings to return, which give a hint, but also are not semantically parsable by a software API. So if you want to do that in orchestration, the problem is like how to, so some people were joking about like putting underscore underscore line and underscore underscore file macros into the error messages, but that doesn't make sense either, so.
Right, so yeah, I'll put, I could, you could use any, what, are you thinking language translations or? No, just English? Or what is the string that you guys do? Well, he says eBPF or?
I have one question about the shared QDisk, guys. Why do you think it would be needed, exactly?
So the motivation for that is to, if you, and again, let's start from thinking from the user perspective, to be able to configure firewall rules or load balancing rules on a bunch of ports that share the same set of rules. So instead of duplicating them, then in the offload, we need to guess that the user actually duplicated the same set of rules and then configure them only once in the hardware. Because in most hardware, there is an ability to point from multiple interfaces to the same TCAMS region. So
okay, so you don't want to share QDisk, you don't want to share the filters and the rules.
Yeah, that's, okay.
Okay.
So, also used to add this question regarding the verifier lock. Yeah, I totally agree. I mean, this ASCII string thing kind of sucks a bit from terms of interface. I mean, it currently works kind of okay-ish. I mean, you can still figure out what the error is if you have a bug in your program that the verifier wouldn't accept, and you can. Figure it out, but there, we also have to find some better way to improve that kind of interface. Maybe also to annotate where that error exactly comes from the C-like source code and things like that. So, but it ties into the same issue that we need some different format. Maybe I don't know.
Yeah, I think that may need to have a discussion. Maybe we can have a discussion before, Hannes, you. We should talk maybe if BPF already has a sample. Sorry.
Yeah, we should talk.
Yeah, go ahead.
We are here. okay, so next session will be switch the buff, and this is the agenda for this buff. First, we will give you a quick update on our status. Then you want to talk about the routing offload issues, then switch the visibility and debuggability. Ordering problems and CPU port, which we probably won't get. So we'll start and we will see.
Yeah. So the status update, we got some nice thing working. We made OSPF working with several machines, with several, you can see with Zorp and Bird and Quagga all together, talking together. Out of the box on our switch dev, that as we implement it is currently working and it's very nice. You can see how you can configure it with Quagga. Okay. All those. And we got traffic and everything is flowing fast, so it's nice. And also BGP over OSPF loopbacks. We got with Quagga, Bird, Quagga, GoBF, GoBGP, all together working out of the box on our Linux with the regular kernel, you know, from tree, everything nice. Okay, again, in traffic.
So we have fully working layer 3 now. layer 2 was done before. Port mirroring, yes, they're moving forward to AC overflow. So this is the status. Okay, now let's talk about a few open issues that we have, that we face. So first one is routing offload abort and how to fix it. So let's start with a little bit history. So the way it was working up till recently is that that the fib called the switch def function, which will then search for the first net device that implement switch callbacks, and then if it find one, the entry was offloaded. If the net device pointed by the route was not a port of that have implement those callbacks, or does not have a sound that implement those callbacks, then the entry was not offloaded. And that's an issue, because when you are offloading a fib or LPM, you must offload all of it or none. You cannot offload part of it, because then you are resulting in the wrong answer, answer to the lookup, right? If you have a full routing table with an entry, which is a management interface in your box, which is not actually a switch or a black hole or some dummy and a device, then your hardware result and the software result will be different, and this is not something you want to do. You want to hardware and software will be in sync, and actually that will give you the correct LPM lookup answer. So another issue that we have done was related to the abort function. So whenever there was a failure in the offload, whether there is an other failure, so other resources exceeded, or there is IP rule that manipulate the fib lookup, then the abort function was triggered, and all the offloaded was deleted from the switch dev. As a result, traffic was forwarding via slow path without any notification to the user. So just to give you some clue what the user will feel, then he had a system that was able to forward 6.4 terabyte of data, and then he got 4 giga in the best case if our software is optimal to forward traffic. So this is not something we probably want to leave as it is. To just kill all the user traffic without telling him there is something terribly wrong in this box, change something. Another issue that, and this is issue number two. Another issue that we want to address is the problem is, okay, let's assume that this event occur, hardware failed to insert an entry, so okay, so I want to delete a few routes and make it work. So unfortunately, in order to return to a full working system with the full offload, you will need to reboot the system to start everything from the beginning. There is no rollback after the abort function was called. So, and this was up till recently. So a week ago, a change was merged, and the change actually moved the offload from the net device to a notifier, meaning that switch dev driver call give a notification services. Each driver can then register to that notification, and then the notification. You get a notification whether the net device is switched dev net device or not. So in case the net device that you received is not a switched dev, what the driver can do then is configure a rule in the hardware with action go to the software, and in that way we are not breaking the fib. So we are not breaking the LPM. We keep the LPM working. That change actually solved issue number one.
So I got a question for you. So does this mean that every driver is going to have some proprietary interface to this hardware if you're going to use this?
I guess it is not a proprietary interface.
Is there a need for an API then? Because there's a fib add, fib delete were part of switch dev interfaces.
The problem is that doesn't work.
It doesn't. That's the experience.
It doesn't work.
Who took Dave's mic? Give him back his mic. Yeah.
So, okay. I want to bang it.
Why does it not work?
Because if you have various layers of layering, you'll add the rule to a device, and then the switch step is somewhere down below or somewhere above, and the switch step op isn't invoked. But it needs to know about these routes.
Right.
That's the thing. It needs to know about all the routes in the system,
exactly.
Regardless of where it directly targets, what NetDev it directly targets.
Is there a synchronization then still?
No. It's a knowledge issue. The switch has to know about all the routes.
But not when somebody adds from user space, I want to offload a route. Now I have to actually add it to the kernel.
Look at his example on the previous page.
A very simple example.
Black hole or dummy routes will be an example of...
Right, if you add a route to a dummy device, it has nothing at all to do with the switch step. The switch step has to know about it.
But this introduces back the original problem that a failure to go into hardware is no longer something that the kernel can indicate. So this recreates the whole bloody mess all over again, where we now have failures that Quagga's already told the rest of the world, I'm ready to handle, and you're screwed.
So we will, actually, this is the rest of the presentation is in order to try to fix that issue.
Okay.
That's exactly the issue of the that we are trying to
solve. The statement is that currently we've recreated the problem that we had solved.
So let's just say, what I'm saying is that we solved number one, right? We have no longer broken fib. Again, let's talk, put the failure for a moment. So in case there is no failure and the hardware can fit all the routes, then we solve number one, we have a working fib. We solve number three, we can recover, we don't need a system to be rebooted, we can recover internally in the driver. But number two stays the same. So whenever there is a failure, what we will see currently is that the entry will be in kernel, not in hardware, and we have a broken system. And again, the user will see nothing. So from user perspective, you configure a route, the route will instantly success. You can actually query the route from the kernel, you will see the route there, but something is broken with the traffic. So that's number two. And the first proposal is to leave it as it is. But as Rizic said, it is probably not usable from user's perspective. This is not something we want to do. You agree?
I love the
call. This is Jiri.
Yes.
Let's move to the second one. Okay, the second one actually is talking about adding making the hardware and the software sync, meaning that whenever an entry fails to insert into the hardware, it will fail to be configured into the kernel as well. In that way, you are totally in sync. The user will get an error message: route insertion fail. So in that again, we solved the issue about the syncing between the kernel and the user. We still have an issue in which maybe there are cases in which the user actually wants to for the kernel and the hardware won't be in sync because, for example, two separate VRF or two separate namespace, two separate domain, and not all of the route should be in the kernel. So this approach limited has contains some limitation in that part.
So when we discussed this in the past, the general consensus has been that the kernel should accept all routes that it can handle, which means that if hardware can't do it in software, right? And that's what happens right now, correct?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so that needs to be the default. If you want to have a new semantic where we fail because the hardware can't do it, that's a new kind of request. A knob is necessary.
So that's actually the next.
Okay.
That's actually the next one. So from that reason, actually, there is another proposal saying that actually there will be a new flag. The new flag that can be set by the user telling what should be the behavior, whether we should accept the route.
So, Matty, even the second, even this doesn't work. So the failure, the synchronous failure, you're going to take a lock on your forwarding path and you're going to wait for hardware. Let's say I'm dumping 200,000 routes, you're going to wait for hardware, and on your hardware, you'll be waiting not a small amount of time to find out if the last route went in. And at that time, what's the kernel doing? Sitting, sleeping? That's not really an option, right? So
okay.
I think this is not enough even now. I think it needs one more component.
So I think the partial failure issue and the asynchronous lots of batch operation issue are two separate things.
I agree, Shajit. So
yeah.
Yes, Dave, I agree with that.
Implementation-wise, we need to solve the problem of insertion rate in the driver. So whether we are doing that asynchronously and ensure that this operation will succeed, or we choose to do it synchronously because we write very efficient code, that's
so
I think maybe you don't grasp what the asynchronous thing is. So let's say that the hardware takes 50 milliseconds to insert a route. It goes all the way inside some engine. It takes a long time for the result to come in.
Yeah.
What some people have decided to do is to return success and then fire. That's illegal. You absolutely cannot do this. You can't do this. You must synchronously return whether it's succeeded or not, because the user can have queued up already another delete command, which depends upon the first one succeeding.
What I'm saying, I'm trying to say different thing. I know how to manage my resources. So when I return okay, maybe the route won't be inserted by, and I assure you that it will be inserted. There is, I reserve space for that route.
Mm-hmm.
So a failure is only a fatal failure. Something is terribly wrong with the device, which anyway you need to reboot it. So if we can do that, and actually we can do that in our hardware, obviously if there is a Tcam-based hardware, you can imagine that I know to manage the resources and I don't need to configure the device in order to know whether there is a free space or not.
So when you queue multiple operations to the device, like multiple adds or multiple deletes, does the dependencies get worked out properly by the hardware?
Right.
It does.
It does. And actually, what I can do doing it asynchronously is batch operation, saying, okay, I have now route, and now while I'm trying to populate this route, I get 10 more, so I can program them in a bulk and get the output to work in most efficient way. But again, we totally understand that if I return an act, that means that I must configure the route.
Okay. If you could guarantee that, except under extraordinary chip error conditions, circumstances, you will insert the route, then I guess it's okay.
Exactly.
Okay. So, two additional things, right? So I think one, this problem is not unique to, I think this should be a generic infrastructure component. In fact, if you roll back 2.5 years, Rupa and Scott had proposed that in the original switch dev, the first slide had it. Like, have an asynchronous predictor. Basically, what you're talking about is having a skid mechanism that predicts up top if this capacity can go in or not and batch that out. But that is a semantic change from today, because today you have no way to say you're exceeding my skid batch. So there is a change from where we are today to make that happen. It won't just be a silent insertion.
I totally agree. So maybe we will put that aside. Let's assume that all the operational sync and we actually have a very good insertion rate. And this is another, I totally agree that this is another talk. We can do it actually during those 2 days to try to figure out how we can expose some asynchronous operations.
Correct. And this is why the old model of using the switch DevOps made it much more simpler, because you could now, in the switch DevOps path, go figure out what the asynchronous and batch rate needs to be. If you're putting it into a notification path, now you're saying you're going to distribute this to, say, potentially multiple drivers,
right,
and each driver could implement a different policy of batching, which will lead to potential inconsistency in the way the kernel will indicate routing completion upstream or to the
outlet. Right? Because if you have a dummy route, you must populate it to multiple devices, which can behave differently.
But they could some fail and some pass.
So right. so the only way around this would be to have two notifications for an add and two notifications for a delete. The first would be a prepare phase where you allocate the resources that guarantee that you can do the insertions, and then you and that can fail. And then you have the rollback thing which unprepares. Right?
Exactly.
And if that succeeds, then you do the notifier that commits everything, and that's guaranteed to succeed.
Exactly.
So that's the only way around this.
I agree.
So actually, we feel like that this is probably the best approach because it is backward compatible. It does not change the current system behavior, and as Dave said, it, kernel. If you are not working with the new model with the new flags, then all the routes are the kernel always allow you to configure the routes, whether the hardware followed it or not, and if there is no space in the hardware, then you are falling back to software forwarding. And if you want to actually do a hardware-only forwarding, you can specify the special flag, and then you will get this, this behavior as well.
Can the special flag be a switched to policy flag, a system?
You're saying some global flag saying this is a system?
Yeah. Because this you're talking about a per-route flag, which means all routing daemons need to change to accommodate that.
I'm not sure because I do think that this should be per VRF, right? Per namespace or per...
Per namespace.
Probably, yes.
The thing I'm concerned about is that the implication is that anyone who uses this flag is prepared to handle it. So if you have a mixture of applications, some of which are able to handle the situation, some of which are not, I don't see what the value is at that point of having a namespace-specific flag.
Okay, so I think routing daemons do handle errors from the kernel for every API they send, so I guess...
Not very well.
I guess then it's a semantic issue.
Yeah.
So okay. You're trying to avoid changes in Quagga or...
Yeah.
Because
you don't want to let the Quagga know where it's running, right? Whether it's on hardware or an ASIC or... I'm not sure what it's going to do knowing that knowledge of offload.
I agree.
Well, what it's going to do is it's going to probably has a notion of script, has a flag.
Steve, no one can hear you.
I'll steal Dave's mic.
Hi, Quagga, as I remember, has its internal rib, and when it updates the kernel, it has a flag that says this is now in the kernel's fib, and if it fails, it just, that flag is like a route that never made it to the kernel. But so it knows the state, it can handle, it knows it got the error, but whether that's useful for the customer is a debatable thing.
I guess, we'll move to, we have a lot of slides. Yeah. We have 10 more slides, 15. No, I won't steal the break. So, so I guess for that subject, we have another. There is another proposal which is like similar to TC, to be able to say software only or hardware only. But to be honest, I feel like I don't understand the use case of hardware only. Because I think this is quite broken in terms of routing table, and software only is actually again. So I don't understand the use case as well. If you have a fib and you have an entry in software which is not in hardware, you are breaking the fib. So I think that the previous proposal is the one that we should implement. That one. That actually enable us to stay by default with the current behavior, and for those who want to have deterministic behavior, and it will give them a flag in order to act as whether the hardware offload only, and if you fail to enter the hardware, then fail the operation. So
I don't think it makes sense to not insert into the software table because the routes are different. The routes are used for so many different things. They determine semantics of so many operations inside the networking stack. It should always be in the software
but
table.
Is it possible that expected performance may suffer because
no? But
mechanism number two
solves that problem.
Yeah, right. Exactly.
The insert fails if you can't put it into hardware.
This solved all issues.
Okay.
Let me jump to the second presentation. So second presentation is about visibility and debuggability. So up till now we show some cool demos with the Quagga and Bird and GoGB working all together, and that's fine, and everybody are happy, and now we are trying to make it as a real product. But in order to make it a real product, we need more than that. We need to have the user ability to understand actually what is really going on. And there are a few issues, two issues that I want to talk about. First is related to when an entry is actually offloaded. And this is actually depending on the hardware. Hardware have a different pipeline and have a different pipeline dependency. There are, for example, hardware that actually when there is a new FIB entry, they can offload it only when there is an ARP and there is an FDB entry as well. So you need all this chain to be valid in order to be able to properly this entry into the hardware. And there are some hardware that work differently, and there is a missing beer, that they need a FIB and ARP, and they actually know to handle the FDB themselves. So there is the real lookup in those hardware, and this is only one example. There are more. And the point is that users should be able to understand when an entry actually got offloaded. And it become more complicated when we are talking about ECMP, when an ECMP entry will be offloaded, and when a tunnel entry will be offloaded. And the idea now, if we look at the current situation, user does not have any clue. You know that a specific entry is configured in the kernel, you don't know whether it is written in the hardware or not. So this is the first issue. Second issue is related again to the difference in the pipeline and the difference in the behavior of the network as a result. Not only between different silicon, even within a single silicon, in most cases there are more than one way to implement something. And actually, there are trade-offs between performance, scalability, insertion rate, and a few other parameters that drivers can actually tweak. And again, users should be able to understand what they get. Users should be able to understand what actually is going on, and users should be able to debug the system and understand why the network behaves like it behaves. And I want to give a few examples. So the first example is talking about ECMP, simple ECMP. So this is what was configured in the Linux, just a route with a free ECMP, both of them with the same weight. So it is quite simple, look very simple. You expect to get a third of the traffic to each one of them. But let's look and examine three or four different hardware. So what the first hardware is the hardware that actually need the adjacency entry to be a power of two. So for this hardware, and this is an example, this is what the driver decided to implement. Sorry, let me go back. So here we see the route, and then there is a table of adjacency, and the table of adjacency contained four entry because we must have it the power of two. So one of the route was duplicated, and the other two routes was have a single instance. So you understand that in this configuration, you have the traffic is not so balanced. 50% of it will go to the ECMP, which is duplicated, and 25% will go to the ECMP, which appear only once. Second hardware actually look quite similar to the first one, and this time the driver decided to actually increase the number of this ECMP. It reduces scalability or the number of ECMP entry that user can configure. This time we configure 16 entry and that just duplicate according to the weight. We try to give the right weight. Still, there is some. It is not 100% accurate. But in this hardware, if you can see, the side of the ECMP actually is part of the route and not part of the ECMP. So again, it tied the different problems. It tied a problem in which an SMP change or an ARP deletion may trigger a lot of route change or a lot of configuration into the hardware, which again affect the insertion rate or deletion rate from the for that hardware. Third example is actually look like a perfect hardware. This hardware actually can implement free ECMP as a free ECMP, so this hardware contains free ECMP. But again, there is an issue with that hardware. This is not an optimal because sometimes users expect to get something that's called consistency, meaning that when a way fail, when an ECMP way fail, they don't want to rehash all the flows, all the two remaining ways and the flows between them. So there is a better way, maybe a better way. Again, this is trade-off to do that, and this is the fourth example. And in this fourth example, we just creating a huge ECMP table, 1K entries, and then allocate 1K bins and spread the ECMP between those bins. And in a one-way fail, we just take all the bins that belongs to the fail ECMP and spread them across the live one. So we saw four examples to implement the same Linux freeway ECMP. And again, in the today's SwitchLev user does not have any clue what was implemented by the driver, by the SwitchLev driver. Another example actually is the router itself. So router itself can be implemented in TCAM. And when you implement router in TCAM, that's nice, that's quite trivial. But again, there is a penalty because insertion rate may sucks. Why? And the reason for that is when you're doing TCAM, there is a real hardware index that you're using. And then sometimes when you're trying to put a rule between two rules, if you have /16 and then /8 below it, and then you have now a new route with /15, then you need to insert that in between. You need to open a hole in the TCAM. You need to copy rules for that. So it may create some trigger some rule copy, may affect an insertion rate. Another implementation of a router may be hash-based. So for that hash-based implementation, you have a tree each and a multiple table. Each table actually is a hash, an exact match. And this is a very naive example for ECMP hash tree implementation, which is actually what we call the left tree. Search for /32, /31, /30, etc. And here, actually, you may suffer from a different latency depending on the amount of prefixes that you have or the structure of the tree. You can imagine that you can build different kind of tree, not all of them naive. So again, same thing, routing table, offload, you may get two different behavior with two from the hardware, and currently we don't have any way to understand what was actually going on in the hardware, and we don't have any way to debug it. And this is the proposed solution. So the proposed solution is actually inspired by John Sasterberg API, thanks, is to be able to explore the hardware table, the relationship between them, and to query the flows and add some counters to those flows. In addition to that, we want to be able to get notification for each flow add and removal from those tables. And the idea is to use a devlink for that. And in general and very high level, this is how it looks like. So here we are, we can query those tables. So this is an example of an hardware that uses actually TCAM. So you can see that the routing table is a TCAM. It do a match on a VRF and an IP prefix. Then it map to an ECMP container and select an adjacency out of it. And then it, from the ECMP, it configured the right VLAN, the right MAC address. So, and this is our query of routing table, ECMP table, and adjacency table look like.
Sorry, Marty.
Yeah.
the purpose of this is exactly what? Discovery of capabilities, or is this now, you want this to be an API of some form?
No, it's not only capabilities, right. It's to discover the tables, the table graph, so the relationship between them.
And the point being what? That I can now add a fib, an ACMP section, the selection in a more optimal way, or?
So first, the first stage is let's understand what is going on. Without any ability to optimize.
Okay, so, here you it's about debuggability.
Yeah.
Okay.
So here you can see actually what is going on. You can see how the router is look like. You can see how the ECMP look like. You can see how it was implemented. Actually, you can see counter for each one of those entries. So you can see your hardware.
So it's more for developer / debug tool.
It is for actually looking because at all the SDK, all the silicon users,
right?
They need something like that. I'm not familiar with any silicon user that don't use
that such a
API, right. That because this is currently what we have.
So something goes wrong and you want to debug and you pull a tool like this.
Yeah. Unfortunately, as we know, when you write the software, there is always something
wrong. I love debugging.
Yeah. That's all.
I still don't understand why you need to expose the layout of the hardware. I think, if I would wait to see more drivers to see if we can expose something abstract so we can kind of group properties and then provide useful information to the user that the user needs. So
this is the thing, that it is actually hardware dependent. Because the way that ECMP is implemented is it is hardware dependent. Whether you are using adjacency or you are squeezing the action to with the FDP and the port to the route, or you're using indirection to ECMP group, or you're going directly into adjacency, this is totally hardware dependent. So I don't see any way to abstract it, but I don't see a reason why you need to abstract it, because then you actually lose all the information you need. Again, at the end, all the users I'm working with need that in order to work. But use the current SDK API, because this is what they have, in order to understand what is actually going on in the hardware. When they see an ECMP that is not balanced as they expect, or something is not working. Eventually, they need to understand what is going on in the hardware itself.
So you're saying it's read-only? Somebody wants?
Oh, yeah.
Is it read-only or read-write?
So I'm not questioning the usefulness of having the instrumentation to. So what I'm questioning is the way to do it. So.
Okay. What was it?
I can maybe just add that we have the same type of thing in our SDK, and it's also used by lots of people, and we could add this to some of the Intel drivers as well. It's quite useful. Cool. For the people that I talk to as well. So there's at least two use cases or two vendors.
Yeah, I like it too. So there's three.
Anybody else?
Oh, okay.
So three hardware vendors are saying yes to this? Say that again. Eh? I don't work for Chelsea. Yeah.
So I guess my time is up, right, Jamal?
Yeah, is there any more questions, or should we let Marty go? Dave, last words of wisdom?
For this particular thing, I think we may need to abstract it. I mean, there is a level of commonality between what all these guys do, although they're each doing things differently. I mean, as a pure debug tool, I'm sure it's fine, but like users are going to have to be able to interpret this data somehow, and that's the thing I'm concerned about.
Yeah.
Wasn't that what was proposed, like in NetDev 01, I think?
And John was trying to write at the time as well.
Just a really minor nit. You should be able to write your tools so that you could, don't have to be root to show the tables.
That's
sounds dangerous.
It depends on what ends up in the hardware. Like once you start putting crypto keys and stuff in there, that's maybe routes are fine, but we have to be careful.
Okay, anybody else? There's a break, I think. Is that break? No? In 20 minutes? Or now?
Now.
Now.
Okay. Okay, let's give it up for Mari.
Thank you.